Hi, I'm Mike Miller. Hope you're having a great day. Thanks so much for watching The Other Side. It's a show I've created to bring talented people to you, talented North Texas musicians and artists, and I'm glad today to have a guy who's a percussionist. I've seen him play drums with various bands. He's a composer, lyricist, and I'm glad to have Adam May out here today.
Thank you, Steve.
Thanks for being here. And so you play percussion for several bands currently, yeah.
Yeah, I got Jay Allard, Ditch Prince, and then my friend Nathan and I have a band called Lilith Davis.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. And that's the stuff that I sent you on the MP3s. Those are like, I guess, the three main things I'm doing right now.
Yeah, and you have a degree in music from UNT?
Mm-hmm. I'm still working on it, for sure.
Oh, you're still in school?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Got to get some money so I can get some classes.
Yeah, it costs a lot to go.
Oh, yeah. It's very expensive. Sometimes it doesn't seem worth it, but definitely with the educators that you have here at North Texas, it actually ends up being.
Yeah, there's cool. Some really noted people here for sure, yeah.
Absolutely.
But as a kid, you studied music as a kid?
Mm-hmm. I guess I started in fifth grade on the double bass.
Oh, really?
And then I totally dropped that after sixth grade, because sixth grade, it was just kind of like an interim instrument before I started percussion, because that's what I really wanted to do.
Yeah.
And then I guess when it came time for like the summer of seventh grade, I started taking lessons from Dr. West at TCU.
Oh, really?
And that kind of just changed my life. I was like, I want to do music for the rest of my life.
And you were studying drum set at the time?
Yeah, I was studying drum set, keyboard, and all the other classical percussion instruments.
Oh, really? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then you got involved with marimba and xylophone and that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very important, I guess, to be like a well-rounded percussionist.
Yeah.
To be able to have a very good marimba skills, because it is kind of a taxing instrument. It's a little foreign at first especially with four mallets. But I think that's also like one of the hardest instruments to really perform and be yourself on, because a lot of times accuracy is a thing that marimbists worry about a lot, which I kind of don't see the point, because I think it's all about performance and not so much about accuracy. But also, if you have the skills to improvise out of your accident, it's also fun. I still work on that to try to like mess up and then get out of it, like just harmonically.
They sound so good, just the sound of the wood and the mallets on the wood.
Absolutely.
The way it bounces, it's just.
And it really like gets in your body. It's like a very resonant instrument, especially with those giant resonators at the bottom. That's what those giant metal things at the bottom are.
Yeah.
That's what really carries that wooden sound.
Carries that wooden sound, yeah.
And my cat actually would just go underneath it. Every time I play it, they just like lie underneath it so that they can like just bathe in that kind of weird reverb.
Yeah, they like that vibration.
Yeah.
So you have a marimba at home?
Mm-hmm.
That's good.
Yeah, it's. I think that's one of the reasons why they're really expensive instruments, so they're really hard to get access to. But there are good, like, paduk is like this sort of synthetic, it's like a mix between synthetic and real wood, and those instruments sound totally fine.
Yeah.
And they're much more affordable than like a rosewood 5-octave marimba.
Oh, yeah.
But string instruments are quite expensive too, so I would say that, you know, it's not really any more than a string instrument, but it's still expensive.
I think that's
also why a lot of people don't play marimba.
It's so hard to keep up with. You have to have a big place to keep it, and then to transport it to a show is logistically challenging, I'm sure.
For sure. Gosh. It's not a mood.
But you go through that work to do that. Do you sometimes show up with marimbas at some of the shows around Denton? Or?
No, I've only shown up with vibes, because
the
vibes that I have are very portable.
Portable, yeah. Are those the metal?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then you have your little pedal
that
will sustain it and everything. Yeah, it's really fun. I kind of like vibes a little more, just because there's a little more expression that you can pull out of it, just because of that pedal.
Yeah. Yeah,
you can choose what
it sounds so magical. Yeah, it just has a really good sound. Do any of your family members play music too, or
no? Both my sisters were in band and orchestra.
Yeah,
and then my eldest sister was a drum major.
Oh, okay.
And, so that's actually where I first saw like drumline happening.
Really,
through
yeah.
my sisters, I was like, wow, that's so cool.
Where did you go to high school?
Lamar High School.
Lamar, here in Denton? Oh, in Arlington.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's where I'm from.
That's the entertainment capital of the Metroplex, I think.
Right.
Did you used to go to Six Flags a lot? And
oh, we did a little bit in fourth grade when I was like real small, but it got old real fast because you just live right there. And it's like Hurricane Harbor, Six Flags, the Dallas Stadium, and then the Minute Maid Stadium. I don't remember what it's called now.
Mm-hmm.
It's the Texas Rangers Stadium. That's what it's always been to me.
Do you like to watch ball games like that, or?
No, I never really was into watching it. I did like playing sports, though.
Really?
Absolutely.
You did sports in high school?
No, just in, I would say, I tried football in seventh grade, and I said, okay, no more. No more sports after this.
Yeah.
And the rest was just banned.
Banned, yeah.
Because that satisfied my PE credit.
Mm-hmm. Jay Alert is one of the bands that you've been working with?
Mm-hmm. Jay Alert is, I guess, what they say, but it's Joel's grandmother's maiden name, Allert.
Oh, really?
Allert. The singer.
Yeah.
And,
I like the music for sure.
It's really
That's one of the MP3s that you sent me.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me. Which we'll include in the show.
For sure. It's really cool stuff. It's very, like, groove-based. A lot of it is kind of just pocket stuff. But there's really cool room for adding a lot of textures.
Oh, yeah.
And especially, like, when you're in the studio, but like live music, it's always fun to just kind of pull out some mounts or pull out some timpani mounts and then just kind of just mix up the textures, because I really think with groove music, that's what kind of lacks sometimes is textures. I think like Fiona Apple has a really good idea of how to make really, really groovy songs with some really cool textures.
I really like her, yeah.
She's insane.
She has a great sound for sure.
Oh, gosh. Yeah.
And Ditch Witch, you work with them as well?
Ditch Prince, yeah.
Ditch Prince?
Yeah.
Oh, my eyesight's getting so bad.
It's okay.
I heard you guys at the Backyard on Bell a couple of weeks ago. I remember that was a very good show.
Yeah, we really liked that show.
The singer writes some of the songs for
most of it. We've been we've been writing a little more for him now, just because it's a little easier for us to get together, because most of us live in Denton and he's in Dallas.
Oh, wow. Uh-huh.
And we've definitely been, with this new EP, it's, I guess, two of his songs and then two songs that we wrote as like a group together.
As a group, yeah. Well, that's a good experience. It's good to be creative at that level for sure.
Absolutely. And it's also fun just to sort of craft things for other people and see how they perform it.
Mm-hmm. I like his vocal style, and he's really has a very flamboyant stage presence. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah, he really likes. I guess both of us. It's two bisexuals and then a homosexual, which is Greg. And so he likes to say that we're a queer band, but it's just like, you know, there's not so much queerness to our lyrics, I don't think, or to our attitude. It seems a little like hetero, but he really likes, both of us, I guess, are really, all three of us really active in the queer community and just like advocates of that. But I would say, yeah, that's, I guess, Greg would like us to be seen as a queer alt pop.
Really? Yeah.
Yeah. Because like there's like something fusion about it that it's like, it kind of gets twisted. It's not just pop. It's like, but there's also like a way we do fusion that's just kind of like, I don't know, it seems, I don't really have a word for it, it's just kind of like silly, silly fusion.
But there's a lot of talent in that band for sure.
Oh yeah. I mean, the fun thing is that we get to like sort of tear at our music sometimes, like together we get to tear it and peel it back, kind of we'll definitely sometimes stretch the beat, but we can all hear that stretching.
Yeah.
And so we all know where we are.
And Nathan is part of that band, Nathan mm-hmm. Finner, yeah. You guys jam together really well, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we've definitely jammed for, like, since we met each other, it was like, oh, my God, you're just like me.
But you're a really good drum set player. I really like to hear you play, you get into some really complex rhythms and so on and so forth.
Yeah, I try to use the sort of the line itself as, like, a texture of its own to sort of, like, pull out these offbeats and pull mm-hmm. out these like things that aren't being played and sort of like push against the the sort of beat, it's already happening.
Mm-hmm.
Or I guess the clave, I forget his name right now, but he talks about songs having claves. Every song has a clave, regardless of if it's Afro-Cuban or not. But you have to find that, and then you get to play with it once you figure out what's that sort of like underlying ostinato underneath all of the other music.
Yeah, like the clave part, whatever. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just.
Or yeah, if like the bass is like doom go doom 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 go doom doom doom, like that would be one, or just like any kind of beat that the sort of the whole band is playing, or is like sort of accenting agogically, would be considered the clave, I guess.
Yeah.
Of that song.
Mm-hmm.
But that's kind of what I try to do. Is I kind of like search for like, okay, what are the patterns that everybody's kind of playing, and mm-hmm. then how do I diversify that pattern, and then also just kind of make it always kind of, it doesn't want to stay as a pattern, it kind of wants to break out of its pattern and change itself. At least that's what I try to do.
But it has such a good feel that way. And
mm-hmm.
is it almost like polyrhythms or?
A little bit. There's definitely like, we play over the bar line a lot, but I try not to talk too much about polyrhythms and hemiolas, because they get a little confusing, but
yeah.
Definitely, yeah, you'll hear us playing like 2/3, because in all pop music, jazz specifically, that's where like a lot of our pop music comes from, is from those old jazz standards.
Oh yeah.
And the 3/2, 2/3 feel is very important to jazz itself, and that just sort of like, that's the sort of what is it, counter, I'd call it a counter rhythm because I don't have any better word for it right now, but that's the sort of like, so if you're in 4/4 and you're playing 3/2, you're sort of like kind of accentuating a 3 feel while you're supposed to, you know, it's like
yeah.
zing ding 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 ding, you're like dang 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 cha to get it cha to get it cha, that's the 2/3 feel.
That's good.
That's really important too. I just like all pop music, so a lot of my feels end up being just kind of like 2/3 or 3/2 things, just like, because that's also, I just think, really a very natural rhythm for mm-hmm. humans to hear and play.
Yeah, to respond to, yeah.
Because it's one of the oldest, like, sort of, I would call it, it's ostinato, is what, like, the a rhythmic pattern that keeps consistency. But it's, yeah, I guess, like, we call it a bell pattern. There's a lot of, like, really ancient rhythms that have just, somehow they end up, you know, like, just being here when popular music starts happening in mm-hmm. the 20s and 30s, and then it just sort of like, the knowledge of it just kind of grows from there. It's
yeah.
It's informed from all the other music around it.
And like some of the modes were used by the ancients as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Like all they could do is play modally, because they really didn't have like the sort of tuning system that
yeah,
we have,
that we
like
had,
in 440
yeah,
hertz.
844, yeah.
So every kind of instrument sounded very different from other instruments. There are plenty of like full ensembles with like all playing the same instrument, but it was very different, and quarter tones were valued, and like the sort of dissonances were valued by ancient peoples, because that sort of was just a part of how their instrument worked.
Mm-hmm.
But I really like the anthropology in like ancient.
It is interesting. Yeah, that's true. We could talk for hours about stuff like that.
For real.
Well, I appreciate you coming down very much, and I've enjoyed hearing you play. Every time I hear you play at the jam, so I've seen you play the drum set a lot, and I knew you were playing with these other guys. But so you guys stay tuned to check out Adam playing some music for you, and thank you very much for watching, and I hope you have a great day.
Hey, y'all, my name is Adam S. Mahut. I guess I'm going to play some bluesy things for y'all. Two are going to be covers, and then I'm going to play an original of mine. But I'm going to do some Patsy Cline first.
I fall to pieces each time I see you again. I fall to pieces. How can I as your friend. You want me to act like we've never kissed. You want me to pretend, pretend we've never met. But each time, and I've tried, but I haven't yet. You walk by and I fall to pieces.
Y'all, that was Patsy Cline's I Fall to Pieces. I guess I'm going to start off next with this song called Tain't Nobody's Business, which is Bessie Smith made it popular in the 30s, I guess. But yeah, let's do that one.
There ain't nothing I can do, no nothing I can say, that folks don't criticize me, so I'm gonna do just as I want to anyway. I don't care if they all despise me. If I should take the notion to jump into the ocean, I ain't nobody's business but my own. Do do. Do, 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 do. If you see me go to church on Sunday, and you see me coming down on Monday, well, ain't nobody's business if I do. Do, 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 do. If my friend ain't got no money, and I say, well, you can have all of mine, honey. Well, it really ain't nobody's business but my own. Rather than persecute me, I suggest that you should have shoot me. Ain't nobody business if I do. Do 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 do. If I give him my last nickel and he leaves me, miracle. Ain't nobody's business if I do, 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 do.
That was Bessie Smith's "Tain't Nobody's Business," and this is an original of mine. I forget what it's called. No, I actually do remember. It's called parentheses necessary close parentheses to be good, and it was about. It's kind of about like neocolonialism and a critique of that. So let's get it going.
The truth. It is never in your interest to tell the truth. 'Cause when you're strapped to the law, honey, it's necessary to be good. Hey, I don't want no cop inside my echo chamber. I only need a porn star to serve tea to the saviors, like the oldest disciple your mama never knew. Well, said I'd drink 100 grand if I could, but it's really necessary I'd be good. Hey, like Dick Spencer, preacher minstrel from a parochial black eye, where Netanyahu the clerk and apartheid collect ties. Oh, peculiar restitution. They steal it on back from the other side. He said, don't sell us short bars, it's really necessary you be good. Saloon. Zuckerberg points his apologies to the generals in the room. Buddha's still eating. He's got better things to do. They said you better move on quick, boys. It's really necessary you be good. Under every concession stand for Leander Jameson's last nose, I confessed, I told him Lima knew. Well, he looked me down from his gun and said, for your sake, it's necessary this be true. Hey, to 666 Fifth Avenue, where Nero hides his embassy, under the light of Cushion's torches, a white dawn insurgency, just innovations on old American sympathies. Hey, well, he tied me to the cross and said, hey, quit screaming now, it's necessary to be still.
Thanks, y'all. That was necessary to be good.
Heavenly Father, for your absence in my life, yeah. Father for endowing me with such faculty for objectivity, by which I meet so many people. I need to teach your lessons too. But this world just doesn't believe in our plans for their Partridge Festival. You want, and money will come.